Hello friends, the former world chess champion Vladimir Kramnik once said that winning a one position is actually one of the most difficult things in chess, and we all agree about this thing. You must have experienced that sometimes in our games we win some material, let's suppose a pawn or a piece, but still we can't win that game. At least it happened with me, so I can say that it's true, okay? But there are some players like our very own Indian superstar Vidit Gujarati, it's not the case. In their games, they play very smoothly after winning some material and they win the game very elegantly. At least they show that it was just like the walk in the park for them. Well, I'm going to show you one of his game which he played exactly in this manner. Okay, there is a lot to learn from this game. So guys, just pay attention to this game and be there with me till the end. Well, this game was played in European online club tournament where Vidit is playing in B group. About this tournament, I would like to say that this tournament is a pretty strong tournament because more than 500 players are participating. Among them, 404 players are title players. And one more interesting fact is that 80 players are above 2600 FIDE rating, guys. So you can understand this is a very strong tournament. And in the first round, Vidit played against Sweden's top player Nils Grandelius, whose rating is 2670. And Vidit did not disappoint us. He played in a very nice game, which I'm going to show you. So I will not take much of your time. We'll be getting straight to the game. But before we go to the game, I would like to say that don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel if you are new here. So the game starts with d4. Okay. Then black plays d5. Nils Grandelius is black. Vidit goes for c4. Then e6 was played. Then knight to c3. Here, Grandelius decided to play a waiting move, that is a6. Well, for Vidit, it is not any new move because Carlsen has already played this move in one of his game, and we all know that the top players always follow each other's game. So c into d5 was played by Vidit, then e captures d5, then knight brings the knight in the center of the board with knight f3, knight f6, and now he takes out his bishop with bishop g5, bishop e6 is played, and now in this position, Vidit decided to play a very committal move, you can say, because now he captures on f6 and he asks his opponent to bring his queen out. Well, the queen has been come out here. Why did he capture his bishop with the knight? Well, he wants to play queen to b3 and attack on pawn on d5 as well as the pawn on b7. Okay, now in order to save the pawn on b7, black has two options. One is like bishop c8, which will lead to this falling of this pawn on d5. And another is a very awkward move, that is rook a7. And that is what which is played in this game. And just to let you know, this is not anything new, okay? Now he plays a3, stopping all the bishop b4 and all those ideas. And one more thing is also that Vidit is waiting, okay? Now his opponent brings back the queen. And now he plays his trademark move, you can say he plays h4. Yes, in last few years, Vidit has implemented this h4, h5, this kind of moves just to intimidate his opponents, and he most of the time succeeds in this thing. His opponent plays bishop e7, and now with it breaks into the center with e4. His idea is obviously to open up the bishop, one thing is there, and control the center, that is the second thing. Well, you might ask me that what happens if we just capture the pawn on e4. Well, in that case, white can play d5, the bishop is being attacked. Okay, our knight can also be captured, but in that case the black's king will be pretty much exposed. If he captures here, then queen will be capturing, and I will say that white means I will at least prefer this position playing from the white side, okay? But there are other alternatives also. Let's suppose he plays bishop to f5 square, then knight d4 will be played, which is centralizing the knight. And if you play bishop g6, it is a mistake because now the h pawn will be handy. It will be played h5 and the bishop will be lost in that case. So he goes back maybe, and then we will be getting our knight in the center. And two knights in the center are like the octopus knights, we know this thing, because they cover 8 squares at the same time, and it is quite dangerous for the opponent. Okay, so opponent will not allow this thing. So obviously he did not play that move. He supports the pawn with c6 move. Now d5 is well supported, but Vidit got the center. He plays e5 in this position. Black plays knight to d7, and now what to do? Well, now the queen's job is done on b3 square, so he puts it back on c2 square, ready to bring the bishop on d3 and put some pressure on this side of the board. Now black plays b5, obviously to bring the dead rook in the game, and after this Vidit plays rook to d1. Well, anticipating that might be that black might play c5 and then he can play d into c5 and the pawn on d5 will be weak. But here I don't know what exactly happened. Nils decided to give up the pawn, or did he made a mistake? We really don't know. But he plays c5 and now he loses the pawn. After d into c5, knight captures c5, and now Vidit kicks away the knight with b4 move. The knight is being attacked, knight is to go back, and now Vidit grabs the first pawn in the game, knight into d5. And now we can say that this is the starting of the smooth play. The elegant play which I was talking about, he plays in a very instructive manner, guys. So from this move onwards, just stay there with me till the end and see the artist, how he paints everything on the board, okay? So black plays queen c7, trying to action the queens and neutralize the position, because the rook will be coming on c3 and there will be some pressure on white. So Vidit did not action the queens, he plays queen to b3. Now castling was done, he plays bishop to e2, going for the castle if it's needed, because bishop was the only one which was not developed. Knight b6 was played, attacking the rook over here, and now rook needs to go back, he goes to d2 square, and now black plays rook d8. Vidit simply captures the rook, because it is said that when we are material up, it is good to action the pieces, okay? There is no harm in it, in that thing. But we should also see which piece to keep on the board and which piece should be exchanged. And he just exchanges the rook because he doesn't want to give up the file for the rook to his opponent, okay? Now queen into d8, black plays this thing with its castles, bringing the rook in the game. And now here you might say that, okay, the support of the h4 pawn is gone. But if black dares to capture on h4, it is a mistake, okay? And it is a very deep mistake and a very instructive, or you can say very interesting idea is there from white side. What you are going to do, means what Vidit is going to do, is like he is going to attack the queen. Now the queen needs to be there on this diagonal because bishop will be lost in that case. So queen must play queen to e7, and now white can play knight into h4, queen into h4. And now you can see the knight and the rook are in the same diagonal. Okay, so white has a very nice idea, that is queen e3, to attack the knight over here. But another thing is also that if you pay attention, this rook is ready to come on d8 square if the queen is not there on this diagonal. So there will be a back rank check and mate. Okay, so here white can play queen to e3. The knight is being attacked, and if you leave the knight will be lost. So black might play knight c8, right? Protecting the knight as well as the rook in this position. And you can say that black is fine because d8 square is guarded. But as I said, if the queen is not there on that diagonal, something is going to happen, and that is going to be a check and mate. So white has a beautiful move, that is queen to h3. Now the queen is being attacked, as well as the knight on c8 is also being attacked. And if you capture the queen, obviously we are not going to capture the queen, we are going to play rook to d8 and it's a check and mate. And if you move the queen anywhere, then obviously we are just going to capture the knight, and still it is going to be a lost position for black after rook to d8. So there was a very interesting deep tactic, you can say, that the pawn on h4 is surprisingly supported in a way, okay? So black plays queen d5, again trying to action the queens. Vidit was in no mood to action the queens, he plays queen to c2. Rook d7 was played by his opponent, now he brings the rook in the game. See, Vidit is playing very smoothly, like he is bringing the pieces in the game, he is controlling the c-file, okay? His opponent is having the d-file, he is saying like, okay, I have the c-file and I also have some play in the position, okay? So black goes behind with queen b7, he plays the bishop to d3 square, putting some pressure on this diagonal. The pawn is being attacked, g6 is played, and now it's time to get some activity with the pawn on h4. So he plays h5 move, king g7, now h into g6, h into g6, and in order to disturb this pawn structure, what will you play? Well, you are absolutely right about this thing if you are thought that e6 is a good move in this position. If black captures f into e6, which was not played in the game, bishop into g6 and black's king will be completely exposed in this case. And I will definitely prefer this playing this position from the white side. Okay, so he plays rook to d6. Now he captures the pawn. Again, if you capture here, do you think that the pawn on g6 is well protected because rook and the king are protecting it? Well, no. Here, white has this nice move, that is bishop into g6. If rook into g6 is played, then Vidit has already planned about knight to e5 check, and the rook will be gone. So let's suppose you play this move. We have this knight into g6, or even queen into g6 is a good idea. If he captures here, then we can bring the rook to e1 square. The king is going to get checkmated very soon because that's what you can say is the fate of the game. He can play queen to g4 check. King will be going here. Again, we can give this rook e3 check. And the king is just going to be cornered. We can play queen d4 check, queen e2 check. It doesn't matter because ultimately it's going to be a check and mate very, very soon. Like this, this, and we can play this. King here, and it's a check and mate. Okay, that was a little bit lengthy variation, I will say. But king into f7 is not a good idea. So he plays queen d5, and now after queen d5, he plays bishop e4, queen into f7, and now he brings the knight in the center of the board with knight e5. The knight is being in the center. It means that white is going to play something like knight into g6 very soon. The bishop is also going to attack. The queen is also there, and black is just lost. Yeah, as you can say that the rest is just a matter of technique, and with it just proves that thing. He exchanges the pieces one after another. Queen c3 check, queen f6. Now the queens are also off the board, and now he goes for the queen side because he was already having two extra pawns on this side of the board. So his main target is just to exchange this pawns on the queen side, and he will be winning. So I'll not comment much about the rest of the game. It was quite smooth. Knight d2 was played. Bishop is being attacked. Bishop goes to c6 square. Now the pawn on b5 is being attacked. Knight b3. The rook is attacked. Rook b1. Again he attacks the knight, but now with it attacks the knight. If you capture on c6, I'll capture on d2, and the two pawns will decide the game. So he plays king to e5 square. Now a into b5, a into b5, and bishop into b5. It can be one of the option, but with it goes for rook e1 check, king f4, and now he captures bishop into b5. Okay, and it is just like two pawns up. His opponent plays rook to d4. He gives g3 check, king f5, king to g2. Rook into b4. Okay, no problem. We are going to give up that pawn, but king is not sufficient because we have this rook, bishop, and these two pawns. They are just going to roll in this position. Rook to e2 was played, and now rook b2. No problem. We are going to push our pawn. f4, rook a2, now g4. These two pawns will be going hand in hand towards the queening square. These are like the baby queens in this position. g5 check, king f7, now f5, king g7. Rook f2, and after the next move his opponent decided to resign the game because now g6 is one of the ideas. Let's suppose you play something like this. Okay, then we can even play g6. King will capture here on we cannot capture king e6, and then f7 pawn and f8 pawn is going to be queening. His opponent just decided to resign the game. So I hope that you have understood that in this game, after winning the pawn, he kept the pieces on the board, and at a very right time he decided to exchange the pieces, and this was the main position, you can say, rook d5. It all started with this position, and I really enjoyed watching this game live also. I hope that you enjoyed my analysis in this game, and in your games you will try to play in this fashion and you will win some games with some patience. Okay, so guys, we'll be meeting with some interesting game very soon. Till that moment, take care and love you all. Bye bye.